I'm really pleased to welcome to the Frontline Club tonight Anna and Guilhem. Just by way of introduction for those who don't know, documentography is a collective of five photographers of very different kinds, from reportage to fine art, I believe. Who've been working together since 2002, 2003, now based in a variety of different parts of the world, which brings its own challenges. Guilhem Alandry is a videographer, photographer, and multimedia producer. He's been particularly successful in his innovative use of interactive 360-degree documentary technique. He's won several awards, partially for that innovative work, including the Olympus Digital Elements Award 2003 and the Olympus Digital Photographer of the Year in the Observer Hodge Awards 2004. And Anna Kåri has worked in the Balkans, Ethiopia, Southern Sudan, and West Africa. Her particular interests are in migration, refugees, identity, and human rights. And her five-year-long project, The Roma Refugees from Kosovo, has won several awards, including the fact that in 2005 she was selected for the World Press Masterclass. So I'm going to just hand over to Anna, who's going to show a short film to start with and say a little bit about that film, and then I'm going to ask some questions so we can talk about the collaborative process and what it means to be a collective. So over to you.
Yeah. Do you want to show the right, yeah?
Yeah, the film. We just thought we'd start with a little 3-minute film that shows one story from each photographer, because we're quite different photographers, even though we work together. And this goes from everything, the kind of things we work from, everything from... lights in my eyes. Everything.
Sorry.
Better stop. Get the sound right as well. From commissions, the first two are commissions. The first one was commissioned by Le Monde magazine. That's Magalies. The second one was commissioned by Time magazine. That's my story on maternal mortality. And then there are three very different personal projects. And Guilhem, when he's not working, he likes to photograph disappearing food traditions in black and white. Although he knows no one will ever buy a black and white photo story on a disappearing food tradition. And then Eduardo, he does these really long-term research into getting into really difficult situations. He did this story about slavery in Brazil, and it took, you know, 6 months to research and get access to go with the federal police, and 3 weeks to shoot, but sold really well. And then the last one is Musis, and she works on really super long-term 5-year projects that are shown in galleries and sold. This particular story, or this particular project, was shown in galleries and sold as a slideshow installation by her two galleries. So, do you have sound? Story about the three healthcare camps that travel around the U.S. for
And that was pre-reform.
Magali works very much on stories and sells to the sort of editorial market. Okay, I'm mixing them up. So this is Guilhem.
So well, this is this was a pilchard factory that was doing salted cured pilchard, and that closed down. It was one of the last one, actually the last one in the UK. Well, actually in the 16th century, there were plenty of them in Cornwall and around. And that was the last operating one. It actually became a museum towards the end.
Sierra Leone has the world's worst or second worst maternal mortality rates, and it's a story shot 2 years ago for Time magazine in the capital. Followed the route for the sort of debt bond slavery from the villages, poor villages in Brazil, to the Amazon is where they end up working and mainly making charcoal. And the more they work, the more debt they have, so they end up never being able to leave. And there's a special force, this federal police force, that goes out and tries to close the whole thing down. And he sort of followed the whole route through. So this is Moose's long-term project on Amanda, young, slightly dysfunctional American mother.
Great, thank you. Maybe you could just tell us a little bit about how documentography came to be, what the inspiration was, and the story.
Well, when we were sort of finishing, some of us, three of us studied together, me, Guilhem, and Moussi. And when we were finishing college and going down to South France for the Photojournalism Festival, so in 2000, 2001, there was a lot of anti-big agency movements. It was a time when Corbis was buying a lot of agencies. They bought Sigma, and you know, there was a lot of fights between the photographers because they were trying to take their copyright, and you know, the whole thing was sort of up in the air. And then there was this whole other movement also happening in France of collectives, which the biggest ones are Tendance Flou and Le Public and Le Bas Florian. Yeah. And they were also in Perpignan and also sort of doing things on their own, you know, and being way more cool and fun. And then I remember the, you know, well, with Loyal Public, they set up all these cushions in the sort of convention center, and they had guitars, and they were making
tea,
Moroccan tea, and they were being really cool. And we were like, wow, this looks much nicer than all the agencies upstairs, which were really serious. So it kind of came out of that whole movement of, you know, going against the big agencies, and also all the agency we'd looked up to when we were studying, they were all failing, you know, in the sort of beginning of. So by, I think it was 2003, I studied photojournalism at LCC and met two other photographers, and we sort of got together. We started out doing a web magazine and inviting anyone who wanted to be part of the web magazine, and we did that for quite a few years, and then started the collective probably in 2003.
Yeah.
By 2004 became more structured, and by 2004 we also got a space in Perpignan. They give spaces to, you know, collectives that are serious, to show their work. And yeah.
And what do you feel that being part of a collective brings you primarily? What are the biggest gains for you as individuals and then as a group together?
Well, I think first of all you're not alone. You have other people around you, and you work towards a similar goal. And also, you have responsibilities towards each other. You know that if you're successful, you will bring success to the others, and vice versa. And therefore, it puts the pressure a bit higher. But also, it means that you feel more safe in a way that, you know, if you chose the right people to surround you, you're going to move forward with them. I mean, photography is often a very lonely profession. Even though we spend our time meeting people, we're actually quite alone, and being together really helps, I think, in that sense. But it's also sharing resources. At the time, you know, when we started, we were students, we didn't have much money, we had to put a website together, and we had different people had different knowledge on technology, and so we helped each other with that and support each other. In terms of story ideas, contacts, editing of stories. And I think we come to a point where we know each other enough to be quite honest about what we feel and not have to be politically correct when we think, you know, a story idea is not great or whatever. We can be quite direct about it and say it. So it's a mix of things. It's a support, essentially.
I mean, I guess we're all still working. I mean, a lot of people stop in the first few years, they stop, and I don't know if we'd all still be working if we hadn't had each other to, because you have responsibilities and deadlines with each other. You can't just go on holiday. Yeah. Well, you can, but you can't. You can't just. There are certain things you have to do, and it becomes kind of embarrassing.
Because I suppose the collective element is more obvious when it comes to collaborative work that you've actually done together. I know that the two of you have collaborated directly, and the whole group have collaborated directly in the past as well. But I suppose it's interesting to think about the more holistic, relational benefits that you get from being a group, even when the individual projects are quite distinctive from one another.
Mm. But of course, there are also, I mean, it's not all great. And that, I mean, I see a lot of collectives starting, and then within a year, you know, I mean, I was looking at a website. I remember meeting a collective, and there were 5 photographers maybe a year ago, and I looked at it yesterday, and there was 2. And I was thinking, that's very. I mean, it seems to be. There's lots of problems at starting. You know, there's lots of discussing and lots of agreeing on things, and you have to compromise on ideas. And can we share? We share a common identity. We have, all our cards are the same. All our, you know, all our visual material is sort of identical, and so we have to agree. And so there's lots of. And in the same way that when you have a success, it reflects well on everyone. You know, if someone has an argument with a picture, it kind of reflects badly on everyone as well. So there's, you know, it's good and bad things. And there are times when we communicate less, you know, and then others.
Yeah. And also being part of a collective allows collaborative projects and coming together on certain projects, either as a whole group or some of the photographers. This was something we were very keen on doing from the start. Sort of managed to come together into one project. So we've done that on a few occasions whenever we could manage, because it's quite a lot of work. And before I continue on the common project things, I think, I mean, one of the specificity of our structure is that we don't actually have employees and we do everything ourselves. So
or we might hire people for specific big projects.
Yeah. But we don't have someone sort of helping with the management and so on. So it's not always easy to bring everyone together and have, you know, sort of leadership towards a project. But the way we operate is that we allocate roles and responsibilities sort of throughout the year, but also specifically for a project. So like one of the photographers might take the role, the leading role in sort of leading a project, basically. And so we did that back in 2004. That was the first time we worked together as a whole group on a photographic project. We had worked together previously, but more on sort of editing the issue web magazine that we were doing at the time. But that was really a photographic project, and it took about 3 or 4 months of preparation, and the project was during the U.S. election back in 2004, and the idea was that 5 of us would split across the U.S. and go into 5 different families. It's there.
It's just a few.
Yeah, we just show a few pictures. We did it for the Guardian website. I mean, what was interesting and how being a collective can be a real advantage is that we proposed that story to the Guardian and say, okay, we're going to spend 10 days in 5 different families across the US and try to have as much as possible the socio-economical spectrum of America, even though it's not that easy with 5 locations and 5 people. But we spend 10 days with one family, each of us, the week leading to the election, until election day. And then every day we would send 5 to 10 pictures to the Guardian website and a bit of audio. It was a really interesting project, but it was also a very hectic project. It was quite tricky to keep going. And there was also a major risk that one of us would fail, one or many of us would fail. So, and that would have put the whole project in shambles and also reflected badly on each of us. So there's also that risk as a collective when you work on a project like this, that if one thing goes wrong for one person, then you can put, you have quite a lot of risk. And that was the first common project we did. It happened to be a success and nothing went wrong.
But it was only possible because Olympus that's were putting true. Out a new camera and decided to
that's the
sponsor,
other thing,
sponsor,
yeah.
The project, so, yeah.
In terms of you know, getting five photographers to the US for 10 days and giving them an assignment, that was quite, that represented quite a lot of money, and The Guardian didn't have the money for that. But we, so we got Olympus on board to sponsor us and helped us to, well, fund the project. So we used their cameras and they gave us some money, and then The Guardian also paid for some of the expenses. And so it was like that, that we could put together a project like this, because very often people ask, like, how could you get such a big commission? Actually, it was not, well, it was shared. It was also one of the first sort of multimedia-oriented project that we did as a group, but we'll talk about that, I think, a bit later.
Yeah.
But that's one of the examples with the audio and stuff.
Yeah. Great. Well, maybe you could talk us through some of what we're seeing here, but first of all, I just want to pick up on the point you made about some of the difficulties inherent in being a group, and we've talked about some of the advantages, and I mentioned earlier that whereas previously you were all located in one geographical place, that now you're beginning to disperse, and just wondering if that's the biggest sort of hurdle that you have in working together, or what some of the other negative aspects are of the process.
I mean, we used to be everyone in London, but that only lasted, I think, 6 months. Then one person went to Paris. And then a few years ago, we went and spent a year in West Africa, and then someone went to Brazil. It is difficult. It's much easier to work as a group in that way when everyone is in the same location, because, yeah, it's easier to have those discussions. And I mean, we're at the moment, we're three, but Musi is moving to Amsterdam. She's got a residency for 2 years, so she's moving in January. So we'll be down to just the two of us, which is a bit depressing, but hopefully we'll keep going. But we use Skype a lot, but it's not quite the same. Mm. Try and get together as much as possible. The difficulty is one member is in Brazil and has a new family, and it's not easy for him to get away, so. Mm. Yeah.
But it is more difficult to work now that we are geographically separated. It was a lot easier when everyone was in London, and just to organize things and to you know, to be on top of each other's when it comes to respecting deadlines and things like this, and also just agreeing on ideas. I mean, I think by definition a collective is quite a democratic structure, and everyone has to agree. So it's, you know, when you have five opinions, if you're sitting around a table, you can come to some sort of
you're
agreement.
Gonna sit there forever, you know?
Yeah, but
if you send an email,
when it's through emails, it's just really difficult. And if you happen to be missing a few days of emails because you're on location shooting or something, then you end up with this endless list of emails where it's like, thanks for sending me this. Oh, great job. Oh, this, and each email is like, you know, just saying nothing really. But it's quite, I mean, as a process, it's quite difficult to organize and to continue working as a group, and not just be a bunch of people together that just work independently, which would be pointless, I think.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, we also get other benefits, like we get assignments, typically very often in the UK, which they don't really mind which photographer does it. Mm-hmm. We get from France or from Denmark, or, you know, from Europe, we get quite a few assignments where the group gets the assignment, and whoever does it,
which is quite interesting considering how different you are in terms of style and approach.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
I mean, as a general rule, Musin doesn't shoot editorial, so it's, yeah, that's true, I guess.
Would you like to talk us through what we're seeing here and show us some of the other multimedia pieces that you've brought?
The U.S. election is a bit old now and it's a bit outdated, but I think what's interesting in it today still is the way it worked and the fact that as a group you could operate that way. Briefly, Anna was in Florida doing the the place in America that had the most
lost votes in the
most lost vote in the previous election. Eduardo was in California with a Hispanic family that had one child in Iraq. I was in Texas in George Bush Village. Magali was in Pennsylvania
in a family where the father was in Iraq.
And the father was in Iraq. By the way, Florida was Democrat, California was Democrat, Texas was Republican, Pennsylvania was Republican, and Muzi was with the Williams family, which...
In Georgia, which was a mixed, like the younger members were Democrat voters and the oldest were those of...
Yeah. But I think, what's really interesting today about this is that we could actually propose such an idea to The Guardian and do a project like this, just like go and do it. Mm-hmm.
It seems to be a lot more difficult with the UK press now. They lack a lot behind what, for example, the French websites or the American websites are doing. They're not investing in proper online multimedia web documentaries. Mm.
Yeah, in terms of the multimedia things, and not just in terms of the collective things, but multimedia has really, or should I say web documentaries, have really sort of kicked off in the last 2 years. And there's a lot of really interesting stuff happening. And one of the projects we did, which was a collaboration between Anna and I, was for Save the Children, and it's called Crew Bay. Can show you a bit of it. Kube is a slum community in Freetown, in Sierra Leone, and we work with Save the Children in for about a year. Well, actually a bit less, 9 months.
It was based on a project.
Yeah.
That Guilhem studied interactive multimedia, and it was based on a project the infrastructure was based on a project you did.
Yeah, back in 2002, we did a project which was a CD-ROM back then, which used 360-degree photography and linked towards different stories, and so we approached Save the Children and Rachel Palmer, who is here tonight, who's been really great at believing in that story from the start and that concept. Anyway, I'll go through it and explain, but. Mm-hmm. The principles are quite simple. You go to a location and you can rotate the pictures. And as you rotate the picture and discover the environment, you come across hotspots and links that take you towards stories. So Kåri is a slum community. It's got about 6,000 people living there. The population has exploded since the Civil War, and it faces today a lot of challenges, especially for children. The conditions of living are terrible, but it's a key location in Freetown because it's very central, and therefore people don't want to relocate anywhere. That's a quick introduction about Kube, but
and, Natalie.
Yeah.
So basically, we went and spent. Well, it was supposed to be 6 months, but actually it became 9 months. And in that time, say the children were implementing certain health projects in the community, such as improving the clinic and water situation, training people to treat diarrhea, one of the biggest problems. So we were sort of following those stories and what was happening in the community. But because we were on the ground, we were also following, and we had enough time, we were also following just more social stories and stories that sort of reflected the community more. And so the children chose Sierra Leone and Freetown because it is the place with the world's highest sort of child mortality rate. So in Sierra Leone, 1 in 4 children die before the age of 5. So that was sort of, it links in with their child survival campaign.
Mm. One of the advantages of doing such a long-term project is that we could follow the stories and follow the people throughout. So we were doing sort of webisodes, every month with different stories, four stories per episode, webisode. And so as a viewer, you could you would be updated with newsletters and stuff, and you could sort of know what has happened to such and such person that you might have seen in a previous episode.
And simultaneously, we did a diary from the clinic staff, did a diary for the BBC website, and so we're sort of linking into a lot of different medias. And are you going to show some of them?
I'm going to show one of the stories, which is a video story. So when you meet Sun Kåri here and her family, and she talks about the costs of a life.
The sound is not very good, unfortunately.
My name is Sunkari Conte. My age is 30. I have four children. My husband, no get work, no get job, nothing, nothing. Now, which are the orange and the cell. So it's difficult for my children to feed them, to take care of them.
Baby, I lost his name, Kadiatu. Kadiatu is sick from diarrhea. Sick at the doctor came, Bungoma kids. Tell me, say, I will pay 90,000. No, Ava. I have 25,000. He's done. He not look the picking. He say 90,000, I have a pin. He not look at. I take a couch. Cannot get the money. Worse no more, the worst no more, the worst no more. I go to the clinic. This clinic now go there. I not get better medicine there. And look around and say, okay, we come with medicine there. This dance. So it's from the 30 minute now. I don't know if I can come to medicine or not. It became like. Why make you die back? Because of poverty. Because if I get money, so say, ah, I'm going to meet you, say 90,000. So if I pay 90,000, say God for me, put it on the table, and meet up the air and measure the men.
So this is the reality of a lot of people, but the other thing about doing this project and what was very clear for us as well as for Save the Children from the start is that we didn't want just to talk about that and again make people look like they just live in terrible conditions all the time. There's actually a lot of stuff going on in slums. People live a fairly normal life.
People adapt.
And people adapt to the life. So we did a lot of other things and a lot of positive stories. For instance, we worked with Double K, which is a local band, and all the music that is on the different videos sometimes have been made with them. We followed them in the studio. And,
they live in the slum.
You know, they made two albums, three albums actually, and we sort of followed one of the album being recorded. We also followed seven women who were pregnant, sort of more or less pregnant, you know, more or less ready to deliver. The thing is, it's kind of all a bit of a guesswork when they're going to deliver. So we follow seven of them and hoping that, you know, they would deliver fairly soon because we had deadlines. It turned out that some were 2 years pregnant, other were like, 6 months pregnant. I mean, we had all sorts of stories, but anyway.
Because the midwife doesn't, she just estimates how pregnant people are. So people there are like, yeah, I'm 11 months pregnant. And you're like, what? Yeah. But she told me I was 7 months pregnant, you know. That, it's quite funny sometimes, the stories, yeah.
But so, yeah, we eventually, just before the deadline, we had a baby girl, and that's when she was just born, a few hours after she was born, and we followed her for 14 months, because we actually stayed 9 months in Sierra Leone, but we went back on a couple of occasions afterwards. So the next picture is her for 14 months later. And so for example, in this one, you have a little photo album where you can see her 2 days old, 1 month old, 2 months old. I'm going a bit fast because I think it's something that actually you should explore on your own rather than me showing you how to do it. But 5 months old, 9 months, and 14 months. She's very healthy, and it was a success story. We also have a little video here where the mother talks about the whole thing before giving birth and then after. So that's one of the success story. There's plenty of stories and things to explore. And one other sort of fun things we did was to do a bit of a fashion show one day, because every Friday people dress up for prayer day, Sierra Leone being mainly Muslim. And so Friday is a dress-up day, and people really make an effort to do a little fashion show. Show you quickly.
This is my favorite day. Sing with me. You know me lollipop. You know me sugar. You know me butts gonna make me feel. Bobo, you know me lollipop. You know me sugar. Me wear them butter. Boy, when me want hey. You know me lollipop. You know me sugar.
So sweet.
You know me butches, but you make me feel up.
Titi, you know me lollipop. You know me sugar. Me wear them butts and dig. Yeah, when me want hey. You know me lollipop. You know me sugar.
So sweet.
You know me butches gonna make me feel up.
So, it was a bit of everything, you know. I invite you to explore it on your own. I think if I show too much of it, it loses a bit of its exciting side. I mean, it's an interactive project, and therefore you should be interacting with it, not me. But yeah, that's a brief introduction.
Right, well, I'm just wondering about the use of the technology itself. I suppose that this multimedia work is fantastically technologically adept and really impressive, but it's also at the same time clearly a logical progression from the stories that you want to tell. It seems like the way that you use multimedia is about the stories that you want to tell, which are complex and ambiguous and have real depth. But I suppose one of the questions that comes up a lot, partly among my students, is use of multimedia and whether how essential it is to have these multimedia skills in order to succeed. And maybe there's kind of a scrambling to learn these ways of working. And I just wonder what your take on that is, both on the one hand wanting to use technology to tell stories well, and on the other feeling that you have to have certain skills in order to get commissions and so on. Whether you have any thoughts on that?
Well, I still think most of the commissions, I mean, it's quite interesting, it goes in waves. I mean, last year I did quite a few multimedia things, and this year almost everything I've done has been as a straight photographer. So it's I'm not sure. I mean, I think there's a lot of sort of audio slideshows produced that are not very interesting. So, but I think it is probably something you at least should have, like, the basic knowledge of using good sound equipment and editing sound. And I mean, sound is the biggest problem. That's where most people fail. I mean, usually sound is essential. I mean, we're still using. We're still using video cameras for when we're shooting, not even though we've got new Canon 5D Mark IIs, because the sound is just, you know, appalling. And I'd just rather take a little HD video camera and do the sound on there, which is much better. So yeah, I think, I mean, as the world moves in that direction, it probably is going to be essential. And it's difficult because you might be a very good photographer, an audio recorder, but not necessarily very good. I mean, I don't think I'm a very good editor. I can do it, but it doesn't excite me. But I get kind of annoyed at fiddling with, yeah, the details, too many details in editing. So,
but that's a great advantage of having each other to be able to share
those. Yeah, he's like a perfectionist, you know, so just put it together rough and hand it over, and he's like, adjusting everything, and yeah, it's great. Yeah, it's you benefit from each other's skills, and yeah, we really.
I think
in
lots
of ways. I mean, in the same way, like, you know, Musi may not she works in fine art, so she may not directly work with us, but she's a really good editor and really good person to talk, you know, ideas through, and she's always very enthusiastic, and she always has a lot of technical issues, that she comes to us for and we come to her for different. So we all complement each other quite well like that. And Eduardo is, I think I'm quite a good picture editor. I'm very good at getting things down to small edits. And Eduardo is very good at making like 200 picture edits that need cutting drastically. So we kind of, we really, in that sense, complement each other. And I think, I mean, you know, people often ask us if we're looking for other members, and personally, in theory, I would really like to have other members because it's always nice, but we have had a member join and leave again because it's, you know, we're such a fixed group that it's just, I think it's very difficult for someone to come and find their space and find their, you know, find what they want. And we're quite committed to being a loose structure and not becoming an agency. And I think the member who did join really wanted us to move towards a more business structure, where we're worried that if we, you know, I think that's where a lot of agencies fail, or a lot of collectives fail, is when they become too much of a business structure and it becomes too much about money, and then somehow someone gets upset they're not making as much as the others, and it becomes a bit of a, so we've tried deliberately to keep it quite loose and not to have to take too many serious business decisions together, because I think that would probably tear us apart, because we all have very different visions about how much money we want to invest and how much, you know. And some people are real risk takers and others are.
Yeah.
So like this, we know we're investing a certain amount of money, and you know, we're not, you know, setting up offices and doing all kinds of things. So
seems like a very delicate balance. I think I was joking earlier that it sounds a bit like a five-way marriage.
Yeah, it does.
Solve these problems together, and it can be emotional sometimes, and it has to be very utilitarian at other times. And
yeah, no, it can be very.
But with big payoffs.
Yeah. But I mean, I think one of the things that also keeps us going is that every year we go to France to the Perpignan Festival, and we have a stand where we meet all the other French collectives. And for us, really, the French collectives are such an inspiration, because they, you know, we all work together. We've got, there's a group of how many? I think 25 collectives that co-fund the magazine. So we produce a magazine every year that's got stories and interviews and. This year there's an interview with us about, you know, making the Kåri project, and there's stories from others and from all over the world. So, and we always have a drink together, like and screenings, and we really support each other. And
also it's very interesting actually to go down there and see how all the other collectives operate, and we don't all operate the same way and don't have all the same definition of what's a collective. I mean, two collectives now have opened offices with galleries, with a gallery inside. Some are working mainly with corporate, they do a lot of corporate work to make money, but then on the side with the gallery, they work with schools, and they have this sort of ongoing program where they try to teach children about photojournalism and the importance of it. And so everyone really takes different approaches, and certain collectives.
We all kind of support each other and have a really good atmosphere when we're there, and we sort of,
Certain collectives certain photographers within the collective don't sign their work. It's collective work, so you never know who took the picture. There's all sorts of approaches and interpretation of what a collective should be. So, and others are very business-minded and business-oriented. So it's just, it's a really interesting sort of thing to explore, a collective, I think.
And there was a great event organized in May, I think it was, was it May? It was called the Encounter of Euro-American Collectives. It was in Madrid, and there was a couple of curators, I guess, who chose 10 collectives from Europe, 10 photographic collectives, both photojournalism and more fine art collectives, and 10 from Latin America. And we all had to produce work for a common exhibition in Madrid, and then and everything was paid for, and it was quite amazing. And then we all, the theme of the work was environment.
Yeah.
So in our case, we decided to work with some of the material we already had.
And also shot new material.
Also shot new material specifically for, and we decided to look at sort of garbage and urbanization. And Magali wanted to do something completely different, so she went and got garbage bags on Saturdays from specific families, and she photographed each bit of garbage. Whereas at the time I was shooting a big job for World Health Organization in 6 different slums, so I I added pictures of sort of people living in slum conditions, and so we always, and then the whole thing was joined together with all the other collectives, and we had a big conference, and it was great. It's really nice, that sort of sense of unity, and especially in South America, there's some amazing and really interesting collectives that are working kind of very progressively and very kind of going away completely from the idea of authorship, and so there's no, you never know which of the 10 photographers took the picture, because they all signed it collectively. So it's quite interesting and inspiring. And yeah, there's also a smaller collective event that was organized, I think, last year in Derby by photo festivals, and they're going to be organizing again next year. This was from the how it was displayed, so we mixed in the pictures. And in this case, we didn't individually sign anything either. So I'm not going to go to the next one.
That's the last one.
Okay.
Yeah. The other aspect of the thing in Madrid was that it was in two parts. One was the exhibition, and then the second part was we had 48 hours, to recreate collectives, sort of to mix up between each other. There was 20 of us, 20 collectives, so about 98 photographers, I think. And we had to shuffle everyone, create new groups, and we were in a little town called Soria in the north of Madrid, quite conservative, and we had to all like go around and shoot something over, well, sort of 24 hours, and then put it into an exhibition. And it's kind of a recipe for a catastrophe, but it just turned out to work, and it was such an inspiring 48 hours. I mean, we didn't sleep, we just edited all night, printed. Yeah. It was really crazy. But it was great, great fun, and people from all around the world, and we just, you know, sort of came up with ideas on this city that we didn't know, and you know, we had to
check out the website.
Yeah, check out the website.
They're going to be doing it next year as well. So
It's called Echo.
Well, Encounters of American collectives.
But Echo. So I think what's also very interesting in the last few years is that collectives now are taken seriously, and it's not just a bunch of friends that get together and just like do stuff. We have events that are organized. I mean, we all arrive at this exhibition with all sorts of preconceived ideas, thinking, oh, it's going to be one of those really badly put up exhibition because we're collectives. You know, we even like sort of had those kind of ideas on ourselves. And then we arrive and the exhibition was amazing, like very, very well produced. And the Festival Visa pour l'Image also is giving a space to collectives. And there's a lot more credibility and space for small structures like ours. And I think it's really important in a world that is increasingly corporate oriented to have like small groups that creatively work together and produce stuff.
Mm. Yeah, I'm really interested in this idea of not signing individual names to images, and I wonder if that means that you have to be a particular kind of photographer to work in this way or to work in this environment. Not everyone's going to be comfortable with not putting their name on their images.
I think so. Yeah, I think
when we do projects together, you never know who did what. I mean,
when we work together, we often don't sign, but also you had a collective in Brazil called Cia de Foto who don't sign. It's always signed Cia de Foto, and but they are three, and they
and a retoucher,
and actually a retoucher as well, four, and they almost live together. You know, it's like it's not just not signing pictures; it's a whole sort of way of life. It's they mix their personal life with their photography, and it's quite. I mean,
There's a collective in Argentina called Soup, where they they've got members in Argentina and they've got some in Europe, and basically, I don't know how many there are, seven. Whatever they make, they share equally.
Mm. Amongst money everyone. Wise, yeah.
Yeah, money wise. So the ones in, you know, in Europe, although they make a lot more, share equally with the ones in Argentina. Mm.
So it sounds like quite a deeply almost political vision as well as a creative one. How important is that aspect of it for you?
Well, personally, I always quite like being the small one, you know, not being the. But I think it's, as you say, yeah, it's important, but maybe less important now than it was when we started. It's mm-hmm. not something we talk about that much anymore, I guess. The world has changed.
Yeah, but as I said before, I think now we have a bit more space and credibility.
And also now it's actually become much, because we all now work a lot and it becomes a lot more difficult to actually put together common projects and do things outside of work because we all have lots of commissions. And so it becomes more of a, you know, when we started out, we were really idealistic. We were doing the web magazine. We were inviting anyone who wanted to be part of the web magazine. They had to, the only thing they had to contribute was £25 to make a card and a list of their contacts, and we'd post the contacts to, you know, the cards to all of the contacts. And it was one of the first web magazines out there. I think it was like third or the fourth. And we got a prize for, you know, Picture of the International for being the best small, you know,
multimedia
production in 2003. And it was really about, you know, getting together and being strong. And the busier you get and the more work you have, it becomes a bit more difficult to uphold your own, to have time to uphold your own ideas.
Mm. Yeah. That's the other thing about, I think, a collective is, at the beginning, a collective is, you know, the
a lifeline, yeah.
And also being a group benefit the individuals. You build as an individual by being part of that group. As the group grows and or gets older, I think it's the opposite that happens, and it's then the each individual photographer, through their success, they have to put back into the group for the group to still have a reason to be. I mean, a perfect example.
Yeah, you have to make space. You have to deliberately say, and
reinvent the definition of the collective. What's the point of being together 10 years later if the whole point of the collective was to just to be a starting platform? Mm-hmm.
There was
10 years down the line,
event,
what do you do?
When was that? Maybe a few months ago. There was a sort of British, more fine art based collective called Photo Debut. And they decided to close down, and they had a big party to close their collective, because they were like, we were called Photo Debut. It was about establishing our careers, and now 10 years down the line, we're all established, and there's no point of having the collective anymore. Mm. So they had a party. Mm. It must have been again, June or something.
Mm. So we have a bit of time left to talk about what the future holds, and I think do you have some work in progress to show us? Or is
we have. We're working currently, and it's very early stage, so please be gentle on us. We're working on a project called 3G.
I guess there's another thing to say about multimedia projects is that we found that to get those ideas funded now is not, we're not going to magazines or newspapers. We're going to sort of to another. This is done in collaboration with the Institute of Development Studies, which is part of Sussex University, and they have a research project into women's empowerment in 6 different countries, and so we're trying to reach a common ground on this web project, where we're going to be going to hopefully 4 different countries. Well, UK, Egypt, this is Egypt, Bangladesh, and Sierra Leone, and interviewing generations of women to look at the changes through their lives and to see so it's a really interesting project, but it's still a sort of work in progress. This is a pilot we've just been putting together, but you still can meet.
The point of the project is to compare 3 generation, grandmother, mother, granddaughter, and see how things have changed. We also ask them to provide objects and talk about the objects and why the objects are important. And so the in the future, when the project will be a bit more complete, you will have the possibility to either look at each family or each person or each group of 3, sorry, by family, or you will also have the possibility to choose, for example, 3 granddaughters from 3 different countries and see their portraits and their interviews on a given topic, and then therefore compare how things are according to countries or how things are according to families.
Mm. So we're basically asking the same 8, I think.
We're asking the same question to each. To each person.
يعني الواحد لما بيكبر برضو
it's quite a difficult matrix to make him
بيفهم برضو الدنيا برضو عاملة ازاي وكده
but we're still in this whole development stage of how exactly it's going to work
so بيدققوا على اي حاجة دلوقتي
There's, I mean, one of the big problems with the web is that you have to stay short.
The
people don't want to watch too much stuff and have too much click and so on. The great thing about video on the web is that at least you can grab the attention a bit longer. It's probably one of the only places where people actually stop and look. But you still have to find that right balance. And at the moment, the project is in infancy and the videos are way too long. It's really tricky to find that balance. And if you were to watch everything, it would probably be a 20-minute piece. And we know that no one will stay 20 minutes to watch just one family. And also the other difficulty we're facing with this project is that from our tests, a bit of user testing, and people tend to feel that once they looked at one family, they've looked at all. They know the project. And therefore, they don't even bother going to see any other families.
I guess that'll change when we have different countries.
We have to work things around. And this is very, as I said, very early stage. It will be very different probably when it's over. When it's complete. when it's over.
I mean, one of the problems is that the academics think it's fine to have like 25 minutes per family. Because you're interested from an academic point of view. So we're having lots of discussions.
And then you have the neighborhood, which is a panoramic again. Again, we're trying to work on that because, I mean, it's a great little thing to have to show where those people are from and where they live, but realistically, not everyone lives in the same street.
Especially when you get to the UK.
So it doesn't necessarily make sense there, but so again, we're working around that. So this is just a little intro. I don't want to go too much into it because it's...
So in about 2 years' time, we might...
But we've got three families from Egypt at the moment. Rural, urban, I mean rural poor, urban poor, and sort of urban middle class or upper class even family, very educated, but throughout the generations, very... but what's very interesting about a project like this, apart from all the technology stuff, and is that it really breaks the sort of preconceived ideas. And when we arrived in Egypt, when we talked with all the academics and tried to work out how it would work, and we said, well, we would like to ask people for an object. Everyone said...
all the Egyptian academics.
They were like, you know what, it's not going to work. Everyone will say, my favorite object is the Quran. And we're like, okay, well, that's okay. And then when we asked, no one ever mentioned the Quran. So it was just quite interesting to...
So even the academics have kind of preconceived ideas about their own.
People have got preconceived ideas about their own countries. And, you know, this family here, I interviewed the grandmother first, and she was in an arranged marriage. And she was just widowed when I arrived, like about... Two months before, she had lost her husband. But they've been together for 40-something years, and he allowed her to study again and to go back to university and so on, and then they build a family together. And so I eventually asked her, you know, do you feel you had a happy marriage? And she was, you know, she thought about it, and she said, well, I think we've been happy, and we succeeded in building our families and learned to know each other and respect each other and so on and so on. So she was obviously quite positive about her marriage. And then I interviewed her daughter, who was a TV presenter, and she's quite cool and trendy and so on. And she divorced her husband twice, the same husband. but she still lives with her husband. You know,
nobody knows. Like,
and that was a love marriage. And then her daughter was very progressive and studying in you know the American university and so on, wouldn't marry a foreigner, and he wasn't like in any way racist. It was just like, I think I'll marry an Egyptian because we just know how it works and it will be a lot easier. The idea of marrying a foreigner was not And it wasn't like a European versus Middle East sort of thing. She was like, I don't even want to marry an Iranian, or, you know, we're just too different. Cultures are too different. It's a lot simpler. So it's just quite interesting how we might think, oh, well, you know, it broke a lot of stereotypes and preconceived ideas for me as well. So, yeah.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you. It's great to see some of what's to come. We've got plenty of time for questions. If anyone wants to raise a hand and start us off with a question for either of these guys.
Hello, I've got a question about the multimedia presentations that you do. I wondered if anyone had done any research on who looks at the multimedia presentations, because I guess there's sort of an anxiety that a lot of photography is produced for other photographers, like a sort of pyramid sales or something like that, where successful photographers provide photos for less successful photographers. So I wondered if you had a comment about that and how it affects the future of multimedia presentations.
I don't have research, I don't know, but what I can say is that, for example, Save the Children has been pushing the Courbet project with schools, and that has been a real success. It's just, you know, it's a different way for children to learn, and it's quite fun, and they learned a lot, and it that was really successful. The children gave great feedback on what they've seen, and that worked really well. I think, I mean, for me, it's very much targeted towards young audiences. I think we're in a world where your attention is taken, you know, your attention span is so short, and you've got so much stuff to look at and be interested in, and we click on the web like crazy, and you know, photojournalism has been through so many crises and so on, and I think it's a way to just like get not just the young public, but a great part of the young public interested in it and involved in it. And it allows to, you know, photography is about like fixing the instant into eternity, and if the young public is less and less interested in photography, there's obviously a problem. We need to get them back onto that, and so I think this, I mean, at least that's what I think. I don't know.
I mean, what's interesting, I think, I mean, there's two versions of the Courbet project. There's a Save the Children version, and there's a more portfolio version. And we put that on our website and didn't. And then we showed it to people in Perpignan, and then we didn't actually promote it. And slowly, 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 without us actually, besides the people we show it to when we go and see meetings, it's become like the most popular part of our site and gets, you know, sometimes gets thousands of hits.
So obviously, in blogs and
yeah, get picked up in a lot of blogs and people. But there is an element of, I mean, of how far do you go for it? You know, you have to be you have to be careful that it doesn't become like a gimmick, that it's still a story, and there's, you know, I think it's a fine line between, and sometimes also I think some stories are too complex, especially, no offense, but older picture editors tend to complain sometimes about too complex, you know, multimedia stories that they feel that they don't know where it begins, where it ends. You know, I guess it is a new generation. Like, you know, picking from everywhere all the time and just seeing bits of it and moving on, and whereas other people struggle with it.
And I don't think the photography public is actually just photographers. I think there's a whole lot of people out there looking for photography, and I think we're just being brainwashed that, you know, photojournalism is dying and so on. And you would be surprised by the number of people who actually look at photography and are interested in it and discuss it on blogs. And there's a real public out there for photography. Exhibitions is the same. You know, exhibitions are successful. Photography books sell.
Mm. Probably more than ever before. Yeah.
It's just that we've been told, you know, that, well, actually the press, people are not interested in photojournalism. They want fashion and light subjects. I don't think it's true. I think it's just those are just commercial decisions, but actually there is a public photojournalism in general. And I don't necessarily mean hardcore stuff. It's just, you know, just stories about people. Mm. People want to know what's going on, and they're interested. So I really think there's a public. And multimedia is part of that. Web documentaries is one aspect of it.
Anyone else?
Hi there. I just wanted to make a point about what you were just talking about there. I'm very lucky. I work at Reuters, and I've worked on a couple of multimedia pieces, and one in particular was Bearing Witness, which was about 5 years of war in Iraq, and it was really interesting to see that we had a really broad spectrum of people watching that, particularly the families of soldiers who were in Iraq, and they were giving us that feedback, so that was wonderful to see. The other thing I wanted to say was about Twitter and how I think social media is really going to help us a lot, because you can just get that work out there now like never before. Mm. And then I just wanted to ask you how you deal with the expectations of the people that you're working with, because it's obviously very collaborative, and what kind of conversations you have about that.
You mean the people we photograph?
Exactly, yep.
The people we photograph?
Yeah, people we photograph.
Do you go in and tell them that you have a particular story in mind? Do they give you feedback as to how... I just wonder about the collaborative process.
Well, I think, first of all, the tricky part with the web is that it becomes available everywhere. I mean, back in the old days, you would, you know, shoot a story in Sierra Leone and publish it in the UK, and probably hardly anyone in Sierra Leone would see it. I think the first thing which is really important for us is to make sure that people really understand the implications. What it means to be on, you know, to take part in this project means that you're going to be online and anyone can see it. So it's not just, it's not one of those publications far away. It's actually available online. So that's, I think that's the first step. And I don't think everyone quite grabs what it means sometimes. So it's quite, it's often an ongoing thing where you know, you make sure that people are happy with that. In terms of collaborations, I mean, it depends on the project. The Krube project, I had a sort of Facebook page, Facebook profile for each person that was part of it, and that was a sort of way for them to, you know, to sort of, well, make a bit of a profile. So, you know, have some of their quotes and pictures and things like this, and also there was a sort of forum there where people could ask questions, and question would be answered. So that was a sort of collaborative aspect.
But for example, in slum, we work with a couple of translators who are quite bad. But mainly, we would tell them about stories that we were interested in finding and ask them if those stories were around. Mm.
Another thing about the translators was how we work with people was that at first we... I mean, Creole is quite an easy language because it's kind of quite English, but not everything is easy. And at first we were quite naive, and the translator is really quite a pushy guy, and he was like telling people, okay, now you have to say that. And so they would, and so then he would translate.
And then he was the public relations manager for the slum. Yeah. So he wanted it to look really, really bad.
He had a bit of an agenda. But eventually we started to understand more and more Creole and spoke it a bit. And so we could calm him down and know what was going on. But at first that was quite tricky to manage. And I think that's often the case with translators. You just never know what's being said.
But what we would do, we would record everything, and a third person would transcribe it. Someone kind of perfect English, because we didn't trust it. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite funny. In the case of the 3G project, we're working with academics, and they find the families that we work with, essentially. So we're not really involved in deciding who.
But I think for me the most difficult, to just to go back to your question, is making sure that people really are clear about what it means. And when they say something and they talk about their, well, when they tell their story, not just when they agree to be part of the project, but even when they tell a story, that they're very conscious about what they're saying, and what they're saying can end up online. And, you know, when...
It's an ethical dilemma we face a lot. I mean, yeah.
I mean, with the three-generation projects, we very often had the husbands in the room, but sometimes, you know, the husbands weren't there, and we really have to make sure that everyone is clear about what's going to happen there, and...
Don't say things they'll regret later.
Yeah.
I think there's another question up near the front. Francesca.
Hello. I just wanted to know the difference between working for editorial magazine and working for a charity. So if you kind of beginning, what's your approach of working for a charity? What would you suggest to do? Is it easy to find, as you say, is it easy to find, to approach a charity and to work for them? How does it work for, let's say, a beginner?
Well, I guess you call the picture editor and ask if you can show your portfolio. Well, because I feel, at least I work mainly on campaigns, so it's not that different, because you're out looking for problems and showing the problems, which you would also be doing if you were doing a story. So that's quite, I feel, at least for me, quite a similar process, where it's more of a different process if you're out maybe showing the work they're doing, which we do sometimes as well. But I mean, for us, it's really shifted, where there used to be quite a lot of editorial, at least, well, for me, I would say. I used to work quite a bit with magazines. It's less and less magazines and more, you know, UN and charities, which is good, I mean.
And also, yeah. I mean...
I'm not sure. I started working quite randomly. I happened to be in Ethiopia visiting my family, which was living in Ethiopia at the time, and there happened to be a famine at the same time. It was my Christmas holiday. I was at university. So I just emailed every single charity I could think of and said, I'm in Ethiopia, there is a famine, can I take some pictures? And that was the first time I ever took any pictures for anyone. And I think it's still, I mean, especially for emergencies, still work quite like that. Whereas I think maybe for longer projects and campaigns, maybe a lot more thought goes into which photography you're going to use and what exactly you're trying to say. Whereas if you're in the right place at the right time, you're definitely going to get someone interested. I mean,
have you found that? Sorry,
no, go ahead.
Have you found that within those different types of work, certain types of picture editor are more open to the idea of taking on a collective to do the work, be NGOs or editorial work, or is that not a factor?
I think it's really, I mean, especially in the UK, I don't think we've ever really convinced anyone that it was a good idea to take on four or five photographers, except that one time in The Guardian. Whereas, for example, the French magazines and French are much more open to collectives because they're much more used to it, and they quite like the idea of collectives more than... there's not many collectives in the UK, it's sort of not really.
Yeah. We did get asked to pitch for a job with Amnesty International France. We didn't get the job at the end, but that was for collectives, and they had that in mind, and that was very clear that they had. They didn't want to tell us much about the project, so I mean, now I know what the project is like because it's been published. But it was about, you know, being in different. You know, again, being able to be in different places and have different visions, and also logistically, you know, be interesting to have a collective. And I think also what I wanted to say about working with magazines and charity, I think what matters is knowing what who you work for, who you work with, or who you want to work with. So it's about knowing your client. You're not going to work the same way if you work for a magazine or a charity. Are you not going to work the same way between charities?
Yeah, like WaterAid doesn't need pictures of kids playing football, you know, or, you know, yeah. Mm.
Like, it's about knowing your clients, and it, like any job, in the same way that if you work for a women's magazine, you might not do the same thing as if you work for...
on the same story.
On the same story for another magazine. I don't know, you know, everyone has got their agendas and their needs, and you answer that as a photographer, so...
Right at the back, I think.
Have you got any plans to do any more similar projects, like the Prude Bay format, or are you constantly looking for new ideas to present your work like this?
I can't hear you, Juliet.
Do you have any other plans to do further projects similar to the format that you did Prude Bay in, or are you constantly looking for new ideas, for example, this project, Three Generations?
So the 360 degree.
Yeah, here. I think there's a lot more to explore with the 360 degree technology. I'd like to do shorter projects.
Mini projects.
Mini project, you know, like a sort of 2 weeks assignment, and be able to do a much smaller project, and also develop the interface and make the interface more complex and the story more simple, or simpler.
But Guilhem did go through a phase where he's like, I'm not doing another quick term, yeah. Because all of a sudden, everybody was, all people would call him or talk to him about was, you know, 360-degree pictures, and he was like, I'm fed up. I want to do other things, you know, I want to...
No, it's tricky.
It's tricky to manage that.
You get pigeonholed very quickly, so you got to be careful about that. But at the same time, if you don't have a style or a specificity, people don't know where to put you, and they don't know what you're good at. So it's about finding that balance. But yeah, I'd love to do more 360-degree web documentaries, but also explore other possibilities. There's a lot going on at the moment online, and in the last 2 years, it's been really exploding, and it's really interesting in what's happening. And so there's some fantastic work being produced. Often it's quite simple, but the story is good. At the end of the day, it's down to the story, and then the interface is quite simple. And it's about finding that balance between linear narrative and non-linear narrative, and there's a lot of stuff going on, and therefore, I mean, we're really at the beginning of something, and we're sort of defining
And I mean, it's not just photographers moving in into web documentaries, it's also filmmakers, you know, and journalists, and so there's a whole loads of projects coming out of, you know, from filmmakers and TV stations and things like that, so it's really...
At Visa pour l'Image, the web documentary award was given to a project called Prison Valley, and that was made by filmmakers. I invite you to have a look at it. I think you should go to the Visa website and have a look, because there's a whole list of projects there, and there's a lot of very good stuff going on. Le Monde website is producing web documentaries, or at least publishing web documentaries. Libération as well in France. There's a lot of things going on, and it's really new, and everyone does it their own way, but sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but it's a really effervescent.
Effervescent?
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on, and it's good. Yeah. So yeah, I definitely intend to do more.
Just because I like the ability to jump in and out of stories, like you're saying, it's not so, it's not, older photographers perhaps don't like that. I think that's perfect for the newer generation, and it's all about people's stories. And it's a perfect way to show that kind of in-depth people's emotions and aspects of their lives. I think it works very well. Well, I'd like to see more.
Thank you.
Hi. In the early days when you were just starting out, how much research did you put into your ideas, and how did you decide which ideas to shoot, which stories to shoot? How much did you have things set up before you went out somewhere?
I'm like constantly researching ideas. It's a bit of a technical problem, because I feel like I get to a point where I feel I've researched this idea so much, in my head I've done it, and then I never do the project, and it just really annoys me. Someone told me that, a photographer told me once, he said, you have to stop talking about your ideas all the time, because you'll never do them, because you'll feel like you've already done them. I was like, oh, actually, you've got a point. I think everybody started out differently. I started out kind of having some backing for some stories. Specifically, I did aim quite a few of my stories at the women's magazine market, because there's quite a few women's magazines, with the only problem that then you need a text to go with it, usually. So I'd kind of work with writers, but I don't know.
It depends on the project. I mean, something like the black and white thing that you saw at the beginning about the pilchard, it's not researched very much, and it's done over a few days, and it's just a very instinctive thing. You find out something, you read an article, you find out about it, you contact the people, you go, you never
try to sell that. It's not short for.
But in terms of the process, it's just you just go and do it, and it's quite instinctive. And other projects, you really have to research them and understand, and it is tricky because, the more you research, the more you feel you've done the project, but at the same time, and sometimes you don't get your answers. Sometimes by researching too much, you become a bit blinded and you don't have that open mind to do a story in a quite instinctive way. So, and I think it depends on the people. Some photographers really need that reassurance that they know what they're talking about. Mm. Others are much more instinctive. I think you need to know at least a little bit about what you're saying, and then you just go and find out. And nothing stops you from doing research afterwards as well. You can do a bit of research, go and shoot a story, and then it's not like set in stone. I don't know if that was the question.
I was going to say that I've seen a couple of times at graduation shows stories that were definitely not researched properly, like stories I know personally or know people who shot, and I go then I read the caption and I'm thinking, someone has just been too obsessed with getting their photography and too, you know, into the photography, and they've sort of slightly twisted things to fit, you know. So I think that's a bit of a maybe the danger in this modern world where it's so easy to go and do a story, and it's so easy to, you know, when, I mean, 10 years ago it was a lot more difficult to do your research, and it's a much easier and a much quicker process now. Maybe you can kind of jump loops, so it's worth making sure you've got your facts right. Yeah.
Mm. We've got time for one more question over here. Oh.
I know this is like a bit of a backward step, but how important was the course that you all met on in sort of like pushing you forward into what you did? It a major like integral part of what you do, or like?
Well, we met on two different courses. So the first was a BA in photography, which was at what was then the Kent Institute of Art and Design in Rochester, and is now the University of Creative Arts. Which was really like an amazing course, super supportive, really good equipment. I wanted to take kind of, I remember I went to Kosovo in the middle of the winter and I wanted to take 2 R sets and like 5 lenses. Six, 7 studio cameras with me, and the college were like, take them. And I was like, okay. I could hardly carry them. And it was, really expensive equipment. They were really supportive and it was great. It was really like, such a great course. Mm. And then I went on to do, I left college, was completely lost, because it's actually a course aimed more at fine art and advertising and photography. Went to do the LCC course, which was then the postgrad diploma. And the most important thing for me doing that course was that, and I'm not sure if it's not really run by the same people, but when we did it, it was really, really practical. It was like, for me, what was really good was the journalism element of it. It was like, we had a journalism tutor, which, you know, was really, really practical. This is how you write a story. This is how you write a news story. You had to pitch stories to each other, and we kind of picked up and did a lot of that. And we do that sometimes in the collective as well. Like if I do that with Magali or Eduardo, or you know, if they're like, oh, I don't know what to do, it's like, okay, you pick a country, and then you've got half an hour to find a story in that country, and it's like a game, you know. Like so, that was really helpful to me, that to learn all that sort of background of research,
finding methods, and
also how. But Guilhem did multimedia, he didn't do photojournalism, so...
No, but I did the BA with Anna in photography, and actually, at the end of the BA, we traditionally you do a show. Our year was a bit bad in terms of like getting together, and the tutors didn't want to really support us in doing a show because they felt that we were not the kind of year that could do that. We just we're too much apart. So we were a bit left on our own to do something at the end of the year, and that's when we created Documentography.
Originally it was a website, yeah.
That was in 2000, that was a website, and that was a sort of platform for young photographers. And then kind of we didn't really quite know what to do with it, and 2 years later we became a collective. But so that came out of that, for example,
yeah,
among those things.
Okay, well, I think that's about all we have time for. I just want to thank Anna and Guilhem for showing us such amazing work and for giving us insights into how it's made in this really unique way. It's fantastic to hear about that. So if you'll join me in